All right.
All right.
Welcome to this week's YAWA. We have another absolutely fantastic collection of questions. Again, it rolls in at around just shy of 100 questions, which is fantastic. We will try to get to as many of them as possible, but we will not be able to get to all of them. So we do have a short segment of show and tell, if you will, to start with. First of all, we're going to say we got this here recently. There we go. We got this here recently from Rob, who just dropped off his dog, Remy, from Montana, and this is Kettle House Brewing Company, a Montana local brew house.
Northwest India Pale Ale. So, if you weren't sure what we're drinking tonight.
Now we know. Thank you, Rob. And by the way, Remy's doing fantastic. Let's see here. Okay.
Mmm. Little citrusy.
Oh yeah, this is tasty.
And I like the compass. That's pretty cool on there.
Yeah, it kind of looks like your compass.
Yeah, I got one of those too.
Woo-woo. Okay, so step one's out of the way. We figured out what we're drinking this evening.
Yes, let me not spill that.
Number two, what do we got over there?
Number two, we were sent a painting, not of a dog, but by a dog. I think it was made by Clued the Dutch Shepherd. I'm not sure which is up or down. Maybe he can tell us.
Let's go with, yeah.
I think that looks good.
So it's up here close. Check a look at that.
He's got his own YouTube channel, I believe,
that yeah, you can
watch him paint these cool little paintings, which are pretty neat.
Absolutely. You can search Clued. We'll throw this up on the website here. Clued Paints. And I think it's actually Poi Dog or something.
We had it pulled up. We were trying to be prepared. And maybe Clued is a she, since the paw print's in pink. I don't know, since Clued is Dutch or something.
Poi Hound is the name of the actual channel. So you can subscribe to Poi Hound, and you can actually follow along with everything that Clued's done, which is a pretty insane amount of accomplishments, from search and rescue to detection work to, I think, even bite work and some other stuff. So definitely check it out, and thank you for the painting. We will find someplace. We'll probably put it up in the new kennel.
Sounds like an appropriate place.
Perfect. All right, what else we got?
I think that's it for our show and tell.
That's it. Short this week, but now we can start answering your questions.
So the first question is from Instagram, NickVanilla956. Why do you guys... Blah, blah, I can't speak it all. Sorry.
Those weren't real words.
I was trying to talk too fast. Why do you guys wear scrubs when dealing with the puppies?
Fantastic question. Do you want to answer it or do you want me to?
Sure, I can answer it. It's a pretty easy and straightforward one. We wear scrubs because we don't want to bring anything into those puppies that could potentially get them sick. So we're trying to scrub in, scrub out as much as possible to maintain as sterile of an environment as we can. We also have a kennel of other dogs in for training. And these little puppies' immune systems definitely aren't fully formed at this point and fully developed. So the cleaner and more hygienic that we can create their environment and keep their environment, the better. So we wash our hands, we put on little booties, we wear scrubs, and we're definitely making sure that those things are cleaned in between going back and forth to the kennel.
Yeah, and I think the other side of it is too, there are quite a few opportunities that Kat and I have where we have clean clothes on and we can go down and work with the puppies or do whatever else, but it's just a good general practice because there are times that, hey, I ran out to the kennel for something and you never know. Something could come back with you. So we try and minimize that as much as possible.
Yes. So.
Good question.
Next question. This is a easy one for Ethan from Bugsy _19.
I like the easy ones.
Any recommendations for neoprene vest brands that will fit GSPs well? They seem hard to find.
Neoprene for duck hunting, I would hope. Rarely is there going to be a situation where you're going to need a neoprene vest for upland hunting. There have been one or two times that it could have been beneficial, but I would say The vests that I found that seem to do the best are called Rigam Right brand. They have a decent vest that fits a majority of pointing or versatile breeds. And then there is another one. I'll have to do a little looking. That's actually made out of wool. And I personally have never used one, but I've heard firsthand that they do work well as well. So I will see if I can come up with the name on that one. But for sure, the ones that I use are Rigam Right branded. So,
like I said, it would be a pretty straightforward one for you. Okay, next question, which I think is a good one because it's had a couple people that asked a similar question on this YAWA. From Ava Thomas on Instagram, how to handle a dog that doesn't have a good first reaction to vibration on a collar. Example, they try to hide and run from it, even if they are in a small space.
Sure.
So we have done a video on this recently with collar conditioning. There was a Weimaraner that we had in for training, and he didn't have the best reaction to vibrate as well. He was trying to avoid or get out of the situation, which it kind of sounds like your dog is trying to do, run and hide from the situation.
Avoiding, yeah.
Yes. And so the way that we went about working through that situation was we made sure we were in an enclosed environment. We were in a fenced in area with no place for them to go and hide and run behind, like getting under a table or into the corner. And then we also attached a check cord so that we could keep his feet moving in our direction, giving him just slight tugs and then letting him decide to make that movement instead of just reeling him all the way in.
Yep, absolutely. I think the key thing with that is that you set up a better situation for your dog. I mean, it's a fairly common thing that we've seen more recently that people are struggling this way. And so you're definitely not alone in that environment, but I think it just comes down to being able to help condition them better. So,
and like Ethan said, just setting up your environment right first. Don't try this when you're in a really cluttery space that your dog can have a lot of opportunities to hide behind. And instead of just, well, let's just throw the collar on them and see what happens, we also think that building momentum in your training session is really important. If your dog's been responding really well to positive reinforcement and clicker training and treats, start your session that way first, then overlay the collar. Once your dog is like, yep, I'm in a kind of a habit of, oh, I just go to mom as soon as she calls me, or I go back and forth between mom and dad, then that collar can actually just be overlaid with the treats as well.
I think the key to the whole process is to understand or to keep in mind that it is a conditioning process. Because I feel like we get the response of, oh, I did all of these sessions. I've built a really good understanding of recall with targeting, and we've established a cue. Dogs are doing great. Throw on the e-collar, and the first session went horrible, and the dog doesn't understand what's going on. Well, it's a multiple session process. You know, you're moving from teaching with positive reinforcement to conditioning with the vibrate as negative reinforcement, and it doesn't happen in just one session. So.
Very good question.
Great question.
And there was somebody else that had a very similar question. I can't find it right now, but refer to this answer. So the next question.
Whoever you are.
Whoever refer. You are. You know who you are, I'm sure.
And if you are here to refer to that question, this is probably your first time to the channel, and we appreciate you tuning in. So hit that subscribe button so you don't miss any of our new videos.
Next question, which is a good one because we get asked this a lot. K. Grant messed it up from Instagram. What makes your lead better or different from the rest on the market?
Aha, great question. So, and when with your lead, I believe he's referring to the
our
only lead that we
lead.
Make,
yeah.
Which is called the easy lead. There are a couple different things that we do with that are going to be different. Is every single piece of the lead is stainless, except for the material. All of the hardware is stainless. 100% stainless steel.
So it's really tough and durable is what Ethan's getting at. Mm-hmm. Stainless steel mm-hmm. hardware, and then the material is biothane, which is a nylon
it's a poly-coated nylon
coated. Yep. So it is really durable. So that's a plus. The other side of it is it's more of a springy material. So when you're teaching healing, it will release properly when the dog is healing in a correct position. And then you can make corrections with that. And then it's supposed to release really, really easily is the whole point of how that process works.
And the lead itself becomes very versatile. So you have a, between the two options, you have the standard leash, which is 4.5 feet long. And then you have the XL, which is 6 feet long, which would be your standard 6 foot leash. And then we utilize this in a couple different formats. You have one, you have a leash that you can walk your dog around on. And then you have the ability to turn it into a slip lead that then can be used, utilized as a head halter style leash for walking. And the material is smooth and soft so that it's not abrasive. And then like Kat was mentioning, springy. So you actually get a pressure on, pressure off from that head halter style of handling. And when you can pull that off of their muzzle, you have a standard slip leash, and then you can pull the rope all the way back through the, all the way back through the ring of the clip, which if you have, if you don't know exactly what we're talking about, definitely check out one of the multiple videos that we show how to utilize this, but then you go all the way back to a leash. So you have lots of, it's very versatile and extremely durable and 100% satisfaction guaranteed, warranted for life, minus chewing.
Yeah, if you just let your dog chew it in half, that's on you and your dog. But that leads into our next question, which is probably the last question for this part. But Steven_Lung on Instagram, how to teach heal and advance the progression with the e-collar as shown on our Instagram.
Oh, cool.
So all of our healing behaviors first started with our easy lead up over the muzzle, and then we're able to transition and progress like you're seeing on our Instagram stories and things like that, as well as some of our YouTube videos. We show this process, so check them out. But we're transitioning from the over the muzzle to a slip style collar lead, and that's using the e-collar and doing some overlaying where when you're tugging on the lead, you're also using the momentary or nick button on the e-collar in conjunction at the same time so that the dog feels the stimulation on their neck at the same time they're feeling that tug on the neck. And then eventually we're going to be able to get away from the tugs and only make those corrections with the e-collar and then go from that slip lead, which you still have quite a bit of control because it's up around the smallest part of the neck. It's sliding really easy to make those corrections, to going just to a clip lead on their flat collar.
100%.
So that's the progression of our easy lead. It goes from up over the muzzle, so flipped up, to slipped around their neck, to just clipped. So flip, flip, flip.
It's as easy as that.
1, 2, 3. So I think that's all we have time for part one. We're trying to break these into smaller segments so that we can upload them faster because our internet sucks.
We're going to take a short break and we'll be right back for part two.